Hey, been a while. I started a new job late last year, which has been taking up most of my time. It's going great, though. I am also working on a longer video, which is going... In the meantime, here's a short video about boxes. Unpacking is not a complicated game at first glance, or second glance. It's the kind of game that you can explain in a few sentences, and which you either instantly understand the appeal of, or likely never will. You play through vignettes of one person's life as she grows up, with each moment focused at a point of moving. The first level has you moving into your own bedroom as a kid, then the next is you moving into your student accommodation, and so on. In each level you have a bunch of boxes which you open up, take out possessions, and arrange and organise them. You get some freedom to put things where you like, but only within reason. That action figure can go on your desk, or on a shelf, or on a windowsill, but you can't put it under your pillow because, well, that would just be silly. And that's basically it. The levels get bigger and the story throws a few twists, but that's really the entire game. If you wanted, you could probably speed through the entire thing in like an hour or two, but if you're the kind of person to do that, then you're probably not the kind of person who'd play this game anyway. Unless you're a speedrunner, but who would possibly? Oh my god! See, the secret here is that while the core objective of the game is, well, unpacking, in reality, this is a game about organization. Now, I hate moving. Been living in the same flat for about 7 years now, and I have no intention of changing that anytime soon, and I also hate cleaning. I've got a big problem with dusting something only to have that dust come back 3 days later. But I love organizing. Give me an empty bookshelf and a pile of reading material, and I will spend the rest of the day making sure they're filed in the right order. Doesn't matter if there isn't a right order, I will find one. Unpacking is a game for me, and for people like me. People who know that just because you can stick all the books on the same shelf and be done with it doesn't mean that you should. You have to space them out, add some variety, make sure the books in the same series are together, get the colours looking nice, and that's looking a bit out of place now, so what if we put this part up here and maybe change these two around, and actually maybe the fantasy books. This is a game where there's an achievement for seeing this and turning it into this, despite the fact that it has no in-game value or prompting. The sorting is its own reward. Okay, that's enough of the generalities, and should be enough to tell you if this is your sort of game or not. But now I want to talk about some of the specifics. It's cheap, go play it if you're interested, but then come back, because for such a simple premise, this thing is a tiny little gem with some absolutely incredible invisible game design under the surface. So here are my favourite bits of the game that I felt like I had to highlight. To me, the mark of a good indie game with a simple premise, such as this one, is how it iterates on that initial idea in order to keep things interesting, without straying too far from its central conceit. The straightforward method is just to keep getting bigger and more complicated. More rooms, more boxes. Okay, now unpack.
In space! Space! Space!
What was that mean, Jesus? But a more thoughtful game will find ways to mix things up while still retaining that core appeal. In that regard, it's really impressive how each level of unpacking adds a little twist. Nothing mind-blowingly off the rails, but a twist nonetheless. Here's the level progression of the game so you can see what I mean. Level 1, tutorial level. You're a kid, you get your own room. Only one room to deal with, and lots of stuffed toys. Level 2, the first proper level. You move into student accommodation. You have two rooms to deal with and a bunch of art supplies. You accidentally make the wooden mannequin dab and get a sticker for it. Level 3, shared accommodation. A bunch of rooms to deal with, and for the first time you have rooms you can't go into. This time the house is filled with a bunch of stuff you can't move because it's not yours, so you're just going to have to work around those dishes in the sink and partially filled shelves, and also a beetle. Also, you and your housemates are a bunch of fucking nerds. Level 4, you move in with your partner. Again, there's a bunch of stuff that's not yours lying around, except this time you can move it, and you have to move it to make space. Also, now you have a beetle. This is shared accommodation again, but unlike the last level, it's fully shared between the two of you, and as you make space for each other, you start to realize that maybe that's what a relationship is. It's two people making room in each other's lives for each other, and you start to think about all the ways your future life will grow and expand and start to wonder if maybe this really is love. Level 5, you move back in with your parents. Crawling in my skin. All the things from the first level that didn't carry over to the others are still here, so now you have to move those around to make space for the new stuff. It's by far the most claustrophobic level in the game. You do still have the beetle. Level 6, new you. First full-size accommodation to yourself, a complete reversal of the previous level. Instead of a single space with lots of boxes requiring lots of careful arranging, now you have tons of rooms to deal with, but the large amount of space gives you ample room to experiment and arrange how you'd like. Also, the beetle died. Level 7, and the reason for the suspiciously generous space allowance of the previous level becomes clear. You're in the same space, and for the first time, you're not unpacking your own belongings, but those of your new partner. You realize that the game basically tricked you into designing your own challenge in the previous level, as you have to awkwardly rearrange things out of their prior place to make new space for another person in your life again. And level 8, the final level. The culmination of everything that came before. No fancy tricks this time, just a two-story monstrosity of a house and boxes, boxes, boxes. This level by itself took me about an hour and a half to complete, although admittedly I spent a lot of that time trying to set the table properly. And there we go, that's it, that's the game, that's unpacking. Every level has its own little theme, whether that's arranging around your housemate's possessions, or trying to cram yourself into a tiny space, or working around the groundwork that you unknowingly laid before. And each level leads on from the previous one in both story and challenge. Each level lasts exactly as long as it needs to, whether for a quick play session or a full marathon. The whole game is just excellently paced from start to finish, which is vitally important when you're working off such a simple core conceit. Additionally, after each level, you get a palette cleanser, which really deserves its own subsection. I don't have much to say about this, but I feel the need to mention it because it's one of my favourite little additions to the game. Once you've finished a level, you get the option to see a replay of your run through with all the pauses taken out. It's both incredibly satisfying and often very funny as you watch items get thrown back and forth at full speed, like the room's being haunted by an incredibly fussy poltergeist. I love this. It's such a simple addition, but one that I never would have thought to include. It gives you a bit of a breather after finishing a level, lets you admire your handiwork and see what areas you spent time on or where you got stuck. It's also a rapid-fire showcase of Unpacking's absolutely incredible sound design. The sound design and composition for Unpacking was done by Jeff Van Dyke, with his wife Angela and daughter Ella also credited. He composed the soundtracks for a couple of other indie games I'm a fan of, and previously won BAFTAs for his work on the Total War games and Alien Isolation, and also drums in a band called Fuzz Pilot. In addition to the very charming soundtrack, Jeff was also in charge of the general sound editing, including the Foley. Foley is essentially the art of recording sound effects for, well, for basically everything. Obviously for games and animated movies, it's important because two computer-generated models colliding won't make any noise by themselves. But for live-action films, it's also vitally important because two computer-generated models colliding won't make any noise by themselves. Okay, but seriously, Foley is an essential part of any piece of visual entertainment. It's not just the obvious stuff, explosions, gunshots and the like, but everything. Almost nothing sounds as you'd expect when put to film, so Foley basically acts as the glue holding the atmosphere of a scene together. You'd be amazed at the sheer amount of work that goes into making a seemingly normal scene sound realistic by adding in additional sound effects. For a fun time, put on a nature documentary or something like that and try and figure out when sound effects were added in post, and I guarantee you'll probably lowball your estimate. As someone who has a meager bit of experience with recording and editing Foley, I can attest that this stuff is hard, and when you get it right, few people are going to notice. Foley is generally an invisible art. It's a classic case of editing that you only see, really, if it goes wrong, which also applies to non-music sound editing as a whole, really. Generally, the only time you'll see Foley mentioned is as a trivia, like the sound for the doors in Star Trek being paper being slid out of an envelope. I don't know what that squeaky bit at the end is, though maybe the paper's damp or something. And if Foley in general is an invisible art, Foley in an unassuming indie game with no big set pieces or dynamic actions of any sort is even invisible-ler. This is a long, roundabout way of bringing up the fact that the Foley in Unpacking is absolutely fantastic, but in an unbelievably subtle way, and I genuinely think it should have won Jeff Van Dyke some sort of award. So immediately after recording this section, Unpacking actually did go on to win a whole bunch of awards, including for its sound design, which on the one hand is obviously great, but on the other hand does make me framing this section as me shining a light on some unseen bit of genius feel a bit deceptive. I could just go back and rewrite this whole section, but I felt like leaving it in, you know, give a peek behind the curtain, because that way I get to feel vindicated for my early prediction and not just like a total idiot. So, yeah, good work, Jeff. Good work, the whole Witchbeam team. You made a great game. Well deserved. Anyway, let's play a quick guessing game. There are 8 levels in Unpacking, but obviously a lot of items and surfaces are shared across them. How many unique Foley files do you think the game contains? For comparison, fellow indie darling Wandersong, which is all about sound and music, has just over 5,000 sound files, which is pretty high for an indie game. Did you guess 7,000 individual sound files? Well, you'd be wrong, because the answer's over 14,000! Unpacking is almost entirely a game about putting things on other things. Every single combination of item and surface has not just one, but multiple sound effects. Not just that, but even the spot you place an object can change how it sounds. Some objects are naturally grouped together into similar sound pools, but even things like different sized bottles have been split into separate categories. And there are even separate sounds just for when you pick up an object. This is an insane amount of work done to create a coherent sonic experience, but it does its job to absolute perfection, and so few people are going to notice the amount of work that went into this. And it makes that final montage of each level even more satisfying. And, as I briefly mentioned, Jeff's work on the actual soundtrack is also excellent. Especially... This is another small moment, but I just have to highlight the fact that the game ends with a song, and an original one written specifically for the game at that.
The moving truck pulls up, there's a knock on the door. Now all your stuff is here, in boxes on the floor.
More games should do this. I'm yet to see a game that wasn't improved by having a specially written song to play over the credits.
There's a zombie on your lawn. There's a zombie on your lawn.
This was a triumph. I'm making a note here. Huge success.
And what's more, the song isn't just some abstract bit of music, it makes diegetic sense in-universe. We're introduced to the protagonist's little baby guitar early on, which she clearly picks up due to her current partner, and it pops up again and again over the rest of the game. Honestly, I'd figured it had just become decoration, as most hobbies I ever pick up do. So kudos, fictional protagonist, for being better at sticking to a practice routine than I ever was. That sounded a lot less depressing in my head. To finish, I want to cycle back to the earlier point I made about the marriage of theme and gameplay. Unpacking has a ton of small stories that play out naturally and wordlessly as you progress through the levels. There's the beetle you get from a housemate, the growing and shrinking collection of soft toys, one of which is kept with you, damaged and thoughtfully repaired before being passed on to the next generation. The photos that are pinned to the fridge or framed or thrown away, the increasingly cracked and chipped toothbrush mug. Little bits of information about the protagonist and their point in life are told through something as simple as what box in what room you pull something out of. There's one moment in particular though that I want to highlight, and it's the one that had me sit down and bash out this video script in a week or so. First, a bit of context and elaboration on how the game mechanics work. Once you've emptied the box, you click it again to fold it and remove it in a very satisfying little animation. Once every box has been taken care of in this manner, the game will start to highlight objects that aren't in their proper place with a red outline and a little sound effect, like so. It's only once every highlighted object has been moved that you get to complete the level. Simple enough. So, level 5. You move back into your old bedroom following a breakup. There's already a unique feel to this level, as aside from the tutorial, it's the smallest and most cramped, as you're moving a good chunk of stuff into just 2 rooms, both of which are already partially filled. You unpack the boxes, fill the shelves, pin up your pictures, awkwardly arrange things on your tiny childhood desk. This level is filled with the feeling of melancholy, especially since you're returning to it after already visiting it once before, so you can see all the little markers of time having passed, and often you are placing older childhood items with newer, sleeker ones. By this point, the game has trained you to associate certain items with a specific place, sometimes based on your own preferences, and sometimes just out of logical sense. Pictures go on the wall, photos go on the fridge or corkboard, yoga mat gets shoved somewhere out of sight. Yes, I know I need the exercise, I'm just busy, okay? What that means is that some items get dealt with almost without thinking, putting them in their appropriate place as soon as they're out of the box. Others, meanwhile, might get put to one side to be dealt with later, once you have a better idea of how much there is left to arrange. So, if you're anything like me, you finish emptying the boxes, and you're left with the usual bits and pieces you hadn't got around to sorting yet. So, you do those, and you're done. Huh. Okay. Now, again, if you're like me, this takes you a while. You check the bathroom, check the cupboards, move a few things around, still getting the same sound. In my case, I even thought the game might have glitched for a moment, but eventually, I spotted it. I know it seems like a minor thing, but in the moment, I was so impressed with how much the game had just told me with so little. It tells us that the photo still means something, otherwise it wouldn't be in these boxes at all, but not so much that it can just go on the corkboard with the cheerful memories. And so, because you can't do anything else by the rules of the game, you're forced to just awkwardly stuff it out of the way, out of mind, but still present, a lingering reminder of a past relationship that you can't bring yourself to get rid of. There's a lot of complicated feelings expressed in this tiny red outline, and it's all delivered to you wordlessly and without any prompting. And the way it does it, by having you, the player, put the picture in the expected place, and then realize their mistake and move it out of the way themselves, does more to put you in the protagonist's shoes than a maudlin cutscene ever could. This was the moment that sold me on Unpacking, and the reason for this video existing. This is the kind of specific interaction that only video games can do, by integrating the gameplay mechanics into the story, and having the player be the one to do the actions themselves. It's a symbol of the thought that's gone into this short little indie gem, and just one of the ways in which a simple game about taking things out of boxes manages to be both a straightforward but engaging story, and a game to buy if you, like me, want that little dopamine rush that comes with having everything in its proper place. At least until you give everything a red outline and unlock the secret Dark Star ending where all the rules are broken and the action figure goes under the pillow.